Hello everybody, this is Ed speaking. Today we're going to be talking about information analysis in design. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you like, please click a like underneath here. If you don't, let us know why so we can do a better job next time. So without further ado, let's do it. So today we're going to be talking about system development and system analysis and design. And if you're studying computer science, you should be able to find some useful material in our discussion today. I'm going to leave a link to my blog underneath the video here, so you should check that out. So to start our conversation today, let's talk about what the objectives of these discussions are today. We're going to describe the purpose of system analysis in design in the development of information system, why it's important, and what kind of role it plays into the life cycle of the development. Also, we're going to explain the six core process of system development life cycle, identify key documents that are used in planning a project. This is very important because every project is basically every guideline to a project, especially a large one, its fundamental is in the documentation. So we need to talk about that carefully as well. And also, we're going to compare the academic approach to a real-life application, because you basically learn the basics on the academics, and then when it comes to the real-life application, you maybe don't notice, but you use these basics to expand to something larger and more complex most of the time. So computers are everywhere today. Microchips impact every part of our lives. We live in a world not only of ambiguous computing, but of pervasive communication and connectivity. Some people are overwhelmed with this. Some people are quite content. So an incredibly large part of our everyday lives depends on computer chips, connection links, and application software. So we're going to be talking about that. But first, we need to actually make some definitions here. We're going to try to analyze what's the difference between computer applications and information system. Basically, a computer application is a software. It's a piece of software that it can be used in a mobile, in an iPhone, maybe in a, it's usually known as an app. And video editing software, for instance, such as Adobe After Effects or Illustrator, are some samples of computer applications. Then what's an information system? Basically, an information system is a collection of those software applications that when put together, return in the end some solution for a task or a business problem. So the definition, one of the definitions of information system is information system is a set of interrelated computer components that collects, processes, stores usually in a database, and provides outputs to complete a business task in the proper required format. This is going to be depending on the project. It's going to be depending on the application that the information system is designed for. So in order to understand how information system is applied to the life cycle development of software, let's imagine an analogous situation here. Let's say you want to build a house. Then you have basically three players in that situation. Have the buyer, have the architect, and then you have the builder. So the buyer is going to communicate to the architect what's his vision to the house. And based on his technical knowledge, the architect is going to advise the buyer on things that he can and he cannot do in order to build this house. So based on the agreements they can come up with, the architect elaborates a plan. So this plan may contain tools that are made of blueprints, drawings, norms, and standards, building layouts. And he's going to use those tools to communicate with the builder, and the builder is going to build your house. So for the software development application, it's basically the same thing. The only difference is that the house now becomes the system, the buyer becomes the client, the architect becomes the system analyst, and the builder becomes the developer. So the tools also change. In this particular case, some of the tools may be client requirements, system architecture, interface, documentation, testing procedures, deploy, and then the deployment package. Especially for a large project, this is a huge undertaking and it requires a team of people to work on that. Usually, when you have requirements like this one here, so in order to apply those tools, you need a system that actually is quite controlled in the way that you develop the software based upon the client requirements. That's when we come to Systems Development Lifecycle or SDLC. And the definition for that is that it identifies all the activities required to build, launch, and maintain the information system. And this basically is a project. So the project has a number of steps that you need to take before you actually start producing the software. So, in this particular case here, we're going to talk about the six core process of SDLC, which is basically made up of six components: identify the problem or need, and then obtain approval to proceed, plan and monitor the project, what to do, how to do it, and who does it, discover and understand the details of the problem or the needs. Design the system components that solve the problem or satisfy the needs, build, test, and integrate system components, and then complete the system tests, and then deploy the solution. Those six steps are the basic approach to the system developments, and they may be changed when it comes to a larger project. So in order to actually do this step by step, you need some process in order to establish each one of those steps. One of the most famous processes to actually develop those processes is called agile development. So agile development is a system that you put a team together, and then its philosophy is basically that no team member or even the user completely understands the problem and complexity of the system while it's in development, because new things show up every day. New requirements, the standards and norms may change. So there's always a need to incorporate into the development solution something new, and the team that's developing the software and the client, they need to come into an agreement in order to actually accommodate those changes. So the project plan must be responsive and anticipate issues along the development. That basically falls in what we were just talking about. Changes must be agile and development flexible to change. So every change that comes into the system development needs to be adapted. It needs to be absorbed by the solution immediately. And those changes, they may be quite extremely hard and costly to the development team. So procedures must be in place to anticipate and even embrace changes and new requirements. This happens all the time, especially when a project is too large. Then clients are always changing their minds. They're always requesting new things, and we need to actually try to accommodate those changes as they come. So for a real world application, let's talk about transportation industry and railway stock, actually railway rolling stock. And the way it works is in railway stock, we use something called Senelec 5126. It's a systematic process that complete the system for the complete system or the project. It oversees all the requirements and all the steps needed in the software development. So it contains the Senelec 5129, which is basically just system integration. Then this contains 5159, which is for hardware development process, and also contains the 5120, 128 for software development process. We're going to be concerned more with the 5128 that discusses about the life cycle of software development. This system is actually split into, actually, this Senelec is a European standard that most of the rolling stock apply to software development. And it's actually broken down into Senelec 5129 for system integration and 5155 for training integration. That covers as well Senelec 5657 for software development process, which is different from 5128 because it's applied only for the train itself. 5128 is for system-wide. It's a little more, it's actually larger, and it applies for train stations and systems systems that are connected to it. So now, comparing SDLC for Senelec standard, we take a look at this V development here. Every system level has a subsystem level. So what's a subsystem level of system level? Basically, it's a breakdown of the higher system into smaller things. So taking a look at this V concept here for SDLC, for Senelec standard, we will see that they start with concept, system definition, risk analysis, system requirements. Then on the system level, we go to system validation, system acceptance, operation and maintenance, and then finally deployment. The subsystem level applies to every system that is underneath the system level. Basically, every system breaks down into smaller subsystems, and that's where we analyze the requirements, design and implementation, then we manufacture, we install, and then we go back to the system level, which is validation, acceptance, operation, and maintenance. When compared to the six core process for SDLC, we will see that identify the problem or need and then obtain approval. This falls under concepts. Then we're going to see the second step, which is plan and monitor the project, what to do, how to do it, and who does it, which falls under system definition. Then we're going to see discovering and understand the details of the problem or the needs, which falls under risk analysis. Step four, design the system components that solve the problem or satisfy the needs, which is basically system requirements. Build, test, and integrate the system components, which is basically system validation, and then complete the system tests and deploy the solution, which falls under system acceptance and operation and maintenance, and then deployments. So I hope you enjoyed this presentation. There's quite a bit to actually look at, but it's basically an introduction of what system analysis and design is and why it's important for the software development lifecycle. I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next video.